I think we have this for, that's for, there's a lot of this information as it relates to the expectors and continuing, and we want to find out some additional information as it relates to the impact on the applicant, and the pipeline, as well as what the building processes. Yes, what's that?
Good afternoon, Chief Minister, City Assessor. There is a, an ordinance, 2012-188, I think it's been sitting with this committee, maybe 4 months now. And now we're revisiting it, I've been asked by, members of the committee to answer a couple of questions that were placed to me. And I've presented that in the form of a memorandum to you that I'll go through it for everyone's sake. The question was asked in regards to the exemption by designation, and possibly placing a moratorium on this process, at this point in time, as to how surrounding, the immediately surrounding localities were handling this issue. I did talk with individuals in Hanover County, in Rockland County, and Chesterfield County, and the result of that conversation was that I was informed that Hanover and Rockland counties do not allow the application process for the exemption by designation. It just, it's a local option, and they do not exercise it, and do not have an application process. County of Chesterfield, on the other hand, still keeps that process open, but it's a slimmed down version as to what we use here in the city of Richmond. They have to make application by, I believe it's August 1st. It's sent to the county attorney because there are some legal issues that we all have to deal with in these applications. And if it clears the county attorney's office and is presented to the Board of Supervisors, who hears it in public hearing. The information that I received from Chesterfield County is that they have very few of these applications to begin with. And when they do consider it, when they do approve it, they do it in their one of their November sessions, and make it effective with the upcoming January 1 land vote. That said, they do limit the credit to the tax bill to $5,000 annually. And that's not per tax parcel, it's per organization. Because it's not unusual for a nonprofit to have several pieces of property, depending on what their function is. But they limit it to, and prorated across the tax parcels that are affected by the request. So obviously there's not much, even at that point, there's not much physical impact to Chesterfield County. I was also asked to present a 5-year trend. I did this by going back 5 years to a base year of 2008. The moratorium on exemptions by designation was put in place by City Council in the early part of 2007, so we did have cases that came before this tax exemption by designation committee that was set up by City Council in early 2007. Basically, it went into moratorium after that public hearing, and we did not change the land book in 2008, 9, 10, and 11 due to that process. It was in early 2012 that the process of moratorium was lifted. The process continued. So, if you look at the accumulation, and I put in here not only the annual loss or and projected losses, but the annual accumulation, because once a property qualifies for exemption by designation and it is given that grace by City Council, then it sits on the land book. There's only 2 or 3 reasons why it would no longer be exempt. If they sell the property, if they change the use to non-qualifying one, situations like that, then that exemption is going to continue year after year. I believe the taxes deferred in 2007 actions was about $212,000. And if you look at the far right column, middle column shows you what we're doing each year and the projection beyond this year. And then the right column shows the cumulative effect of that. And you want to get here.
Thank you, question.
One quick question. So the annual loss column in the handout, you've got projections going out until 2017. But if this paper before us is forwarded, it would set the cap there, and therefore our carry accumulated loss would not be as you projected here?
It would not be beyond the 2013 year. I think at this point, because we've collected applications through September 1st of 2012 for consideration for the 2013 land book, that it was agreed that we're committed to hearing those cases, which now have accumulated to 19 tax parcels. And I think my last estimate was about 16 tax parcels, a loss of about $170,000 in that area. Now it's been confirmed. And this is all subject to you approving it when it comes before you, but it's 19 parcels that are going to public hearing, and the taxes to be deferred if all of them pass your muster. It's about $200,000 on the 2013 angle. And then you have the ones from the prior years that just keep. I did not try to reflect the, obviously assessments change, and so there's some market change that's going to occur to these properties over the years, but I did not reflect that. It's, at this point, it's not significant.
Any questions?
We have access to maybe a city map that shows geographically where these parcels are. We have high value property downtown and lower value properties further away. How does the demographic of these properties, what does it look like?
Well, if it's an office building and it's in the central business district, it's probably more valuable office building. That's probably not the significant number to look at. It's the property accumulated by an organization and its purpose. For instance, we have on this list of 19 coming up an apartment complex. That's for, I believe it's 55 and older. And it's already receiving partial exemption through a state code, which means it's classed and we have to do it. But they're coming to us this year to exempt the remainder of the assessment. And I believe that's in the neighborhood of $3 million plus on the value of the property. That's about the most valuable. We have several foundations. If you have not received them, maybe I should just resend the list to the committee. I did that earlier, but the background on exemptions is that in Virginia, in the city of Richmond, we assess, that doesn't mean you're getting any money from that potential. We assess and value all property in the corporate limits, regardless of its use or its classification. The state constitution and the state code dictates to some extent what properties the localities cannot collect taxes on. It doesn't mean there's not an assessment sitting there, it's just coded so that no tax bill is generated. And there are about eight or so classes that the state says, as long as it's not tied to that, you have to use it for the purposes, it has to be title property, and a couple other, it has to be illegal use, those kind of things. But if they do all that, then we have no choice. We have to exempt. So the most obvious one is churches. Federal property, state property, subdivisions of the state. So we don't really have an option there as long as they qualify themselves. And that's what
other consideration rise to the level that is the benefit to the locality, not the church and those things. And these are the nonprofit groups that we talk about as being designated partners.
The question is, can it split a public hearing, if you want to speak in favor or opposition?
Madam Chair, members of the Finance Committee, my name is Michael Gilbert, and I would like to speak to you again as a private citizen, as the co-founder and executive director of a nonprofit, a 501c3 called Bright Richmond, that's here in the area. And I'm speaking to the surprise, I think, of some, but in favor of this, and I'll explain why. To me, for instance, if we take, if there's a nonprofit that's truly doing the Lord's work, let's say maybe in an area where there's a higher crime rate, or something along those lines, to provide service to those citizens, part of the tax, the real estate tax, and a portion of that goes to the police, fire, and trash removal. And to me, and I don't necessarily have hard data to back this up, but just thinking through logically, if you're in an area doing the Lord's work, and there's a higher propensity for crime in that area, and that also suggests there's probably a higher propensity for you to use police and fire services, in addition to just having your trash removed. And so as a result, it seems to me that nonprofits should be paying more into that system. For instance, the apartment complex 55 and older, as compared to an apartment complex for 20-somethings and older, I think the 55 and older one has a higher propensity to call the fire department because somebody had a heart attack. And so by having that a moratorium, you can recoup some of those costs. Whereas if you don't get the moratorium, that burden is then shifted onto other citizens of the city. And philosophically, if the nonprofit is not going to pay their share for the services and the burden is shifted to the public, it in some ways to me seems to imply tacit consent with that nonprofit's mission. Because now I'm basically paying for that nonprofit's use or for that nonprofit to exist successfully have their trash picked up. And that philosophically just doesn't sit that well with me. I do want to make sure that we're not stifling innovation of nonprofits, or we're not stifling the nonprofits to be successful when they carry their mission out. You know, I can certainly imagine that there may be a nonprofit that says, you know, we literally, if we have to pay real estate tax, we won't be able to come into business, or we'll go out of business rather. And I don't think that this paper, or I don't think that there's anything that exists like that that would affect, but that is something that I'm sensitive to. But like I said, overall, I do support this, mainly because, as it is now, you know, for instance, the Brook Theater, they have tons of trash. They don't pay anything towards having their trash removed because their property is exempt. You know, there is, say, for instance, police that have a fire that need to be called in the theater, the borough then doesn't pay a share of that. And I just want to make sure that we all are paying our fair shares. And me, again, as a director and co-founder of a nonprofit, I do want to do the right thing and pay my fair share for services that I use in the city. So that's why I support this. Thank you.
Thank you.
April 8th.
too, we're not going to hear this, would you just hear, I'm not going to hear this favor until then?
No, no. If the code states that you have to get a report from tax exemption by designation committee by February 1st, we amended that first until the extension to February 13th. Next meeting is February, I'm sorry, March 21st. So it's not, the deadline is extended to March 21st to receive a report from the designation committee. The second thing that we'll see is that all legislation can be introduced on March 15th. Obviously, since we're not going to get a report until March 21st, we've extended that deadline as well to April 8th.
Does that change the date that we're going to effect?
It has changed the date that you can actually have, the deadline date that you actually can have the legislation introduced by April 8th. Code states March 15th, now I'm trying to extend that to April 8th.
What we are trying to do is make sure that there is a cutoff so that people aren't applying in this legislation is going to be put into effect. How do we, I'm okay with putting it off, I understand what you're saying, but how do we get it so that it syncs up?
To bring the words with the city attorney's office, just as a point of clarification, this paper, this is currently written, does two things. The first thing it does is it amends the city code to provide for a moratorium. The second thing that it does is it establishes some temporary deadlines so that any applications that are currently in the pipeline, so to speak, and I think Mr. Hester indicated that there were about 19 or so that are already in the pipeline, could still be reviewed and not be out of compliance with the deadlines set forth in the city code. So presumably, if this paper is adopted, what happened is the moratorium would go into effect, which means that Mr. Hester could not accept any new applications for exempt tax exemption until the council changed the law to say otherwise. And then the other thing that would happen is the applications that have already been submitted to this office could still be reviewed, and the effective date of the exemption that they would be applying for would be effective for this tax year, January 1st, 2013. And as Mr. Hurst indicated, what's happened is, it's my understanding that the committee, because we were anticipating a moratorium and we were trying to identify what was going to happen with this paper, the committee has not had an opportunity to review all the applications and obviously meet to have their public hearing. They won't be able to meet until probably the end of February, which is when everyone will be available. So because that date is going to be after the February 1st due date for their report, obviously we recommended that we temporarily change the deadline for them to submit the report to the March 21st date, thereby having to extend the deadline for the council to introduce any papers to exempt properties from taxation to April 8th. Those are dates, some of which that our office proposed, some of which was proposed to us, so if those dates don't work for the committee, of course, those amendments, if the committee so desires, can be made. So I think what Mr. Hurst is indicating is that the ordinance number 2012-188 be amended to accommodate those new dates.
So we would amend it the next council meeting,
right,
in the year.
And it will be continued to the next meeting.
Okay. Thank you. Back to council for discussion. I would like to hear